Welcome once again to yet another in my series of Roombound Ruminations. Here in Western Australia, we have been greatly pleased with the response of both the national government and the state government, and have hopes that in the coming days we'll be able to get out and about a little bit more, and perhaps at that point this will become an out and about observation, not a Roombound Rumination. But one way or the other, it's a wonderful opportunity to think a little bit longer term about developments here in Australia and in the region and more globally. And the issue that has occupied much of my thinking recently, and I think you'll understand why, is that of expertise and our relative respect for, understanding of, and ability to follow expertise in the public sphere. Many of you will know the work of Professor Tom Nichols, a professor at the U.S. Naval War College. Tom is known as a Russia specialist, a nuclear weapons specialist, as a national security specialist, but perhaps he's best known these days for a book he authored with the Oxford University Press back in 2017 entitled The Death of Expertise, The Campaign Against Established Knowledge and Why It Matters. Tom is these days probably my favorite curmudgeon on Twitter. I follow him religiously just because of his observations on everything from politics to the full spectrum of political and foreign policy developments. And I find his insights extremely useful. The book itself is a tour de force. It focuses on how the U.S. public has become increasingly hostile to the very idea of expertise. It focuses, understandably, on the information age and how we are now flooded with too much information and the inability that we now have to prioritize it or analyze it. And obviously, the fundamental challenge in this era of people conflating opinion with fact. Now, there are obvious parallels between this question of expertise and the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. But before I delve down that rabbit hole, I thought I might focus on an issue that is nearer and dearer to my own interests and my own expertise, and that is North Korea. For most of you, you'll know I've been working on issues related to the Korean Peninsula and in North Korea itself for nearly 30 years. And yet I am actually hesitant to apply the title expertise to myself. Many of you will recall Walter Mondale, a wonderful man, the former United States Vice President, former Senator from Minnesota, presidential candidate in 1984, who also served as the United States Ambassador to Japan. I was also very fortunate to have him serve as the chairman of my board of directors when I was in Washington, D.C., and there's not a better man on the planet. But when he was ambassador, Walter Mondale gave a quick response to the media, which I've always kind of held close to the heart, which is to say that if anybody tells you that they're an expert on North Korea, watch out. And as a result, I've always preferred the title specialist, to say that I specialize in North Korea and I've worked on it for a long time. Now, the truth is, we actually know more about North Korea today than we ever have before. There is a growing and remarkably impressive field of scholars on North Korea, not just in Washington, D.C., but of course in Seoul and in Beijing and in London, here in Australia and around the globe. So our understanding of that hermit kingdom is greater than we've ever had before. And yet, for the last 3 or 4 weeks, there was this flurry of global speculation about the status of North Korean leader Kim Jong-un. Did he have a heart attack? Was he dead? Was he in a coma? What were the implications? Or were we at the brink of war as a result of it? And it was story feeding upon story that led to this real media and global attention frenzy without a lot of substance behind it. It peaked when that noted pinnacle of all foreign policy expertise, the celebrity gossip site TMZ, reported breathlessly that Kim Jong-un had died, and when manga makers in Japan made a manga magazine touting the heroics of his younger sister and possible successor, Kim Yo-jung. But in the end, when Kim Jong apparently reappeared, all of a sudden there were voices out there saying that the field of North Korean studies had discredited itself. Now, for the record, those friends of mine and peers that I've worked with for the better part of 3 years, almost to a person, were responsible and cautious. That's something working on North Korea trains you to do, none of them leapt to you know, they gave understandable analysis as to you know what it might mean if it were true, but almost to a person, they were cautious about jumping to the conclusion that he was indeed sick, that he was indeed dead. In fact, many of them had seen similar experiences in the past. I myself, in an interview with the Wall Street Journal, somewhat cheekily noted that over the course of 30 years and working in North Korea, I had seen no fewer than 30 reports of the death of a North Korean leader, and only on two occasions, once in 1984 with Kim Il-sung and once in 2011 with Kim Jong-il, had they proven to be true. And so there's an inherent level of cautiousness that comes with experience. In the end, context matters, experience matters, expertise matters, and I don't think we necessarily saw that in the reporting on North Korea. Now, that's not a generational thing. I might be increasingly a curmudgeon myself, but we actually have a number of very impressive younger scholars coming up. This is really more of a question of talking heads on the media quoting themselves, and experience, inexperience in some governments that led to a lot of speculation, which did not advance knowledge on that topic. Now, the obvious connections, obviously, are with COVID-19. Because today you cannot pick up a newspaper, turn on a radio, or turn on the TV, or read a story on the internet without seeing the day on, day out debate about expertise. Should we wear face masks? You know, should we do social isolation? At what point should economies be reopened? And do we trust medical expertise? Are the medical expertise all lying to us? And we live in a remarkable, what increasingly seems to be for many, kind of a fact-free zone where expertise is regularly demeaned and discounted, and there are consequences for that. And no country is that more apparent than in the United States. It is worthwhile, however, pointing out that there are alternatives to that. There was a wonderful article in the New York Times in just 2 weeks ago, in late April, I think April 24th of this year, written by Damien Cave, focusing on the unique experiences of Australia and New Zealand. Now, the interesting thing here is that Australia and New Zealand have different governments and very different leaders. One is a darling of the left in Jacinta Ardern in New Zealand, and our own Prime Minister here in Australia, Scott Morrison, leans definitely to the right on these issues. And yet, the response in both Australia and New Zealand has been among the most effective in the world, coming at it from different partisan bases. Yet, to use the words of Damien Cave, he said both these countries were throwback to democracy in which partisanship recedes, experts leads, and quiet coordination matters more than firing up the base. Now, neither Australia nor New Zealand are out of the woods on this. There are hard days to come, and the process of reopening will certainly be more difficult than the process of closing down. But we're also not alone. There is the world-leading experience of Taiwan. It just helps to have an epidemiologist as the vice president of the country. So despite their close proximity to the origins of the virus, they've probably had the most effective response to date. There's probably no other example that is more telling in comparison than that of South Korea. In January, the 20th of January of this year, to be exact, South Korea and the United States both reported their first case of the COVID-19 virus on the exact same day. By mid-March of this year, both countries had 90 confirmed mortalities. And yet, less than 2 months after that point, South Korea has now reported 528 mortalities. And today, the United States just crossed the unfortunate milestone of 81,000 deaths. Now, it's true that the United States has a population over six times greater than that of South Korea, but even when you factor in population, that means that the United States has had a death rate, a mortality rate as a result of the COVID-19 virus that is more than 50 times greater than that found in South Korea. And there is really no other explanation for the difference, given the timing and the phrasing of it, than the nature of the response. In South Korea, with deep experience that came out of the SARS virus and the MERS virus and previous avian flus, the response was quick, and it was very science-led. There was a focus on testing, on tracing and tracking, and on isolation. And that model and various variations of that has proven successful on most countries around the world. And the noticeable exceptions where that hasn't been followed to the same degree of rigor have obviously seen the worst outcomes. And as a result, we're in a very strange situation where the failed outcomes are now leads to even more attacks on the expertise that led to the positive outcomes in other countries. And they're all being seen to be viewed increasingly in a bubble. The thing here that frightens me, to go back to Tom Nichols and his book on the death of expertise, is that for the last 3 years in various promotional tours, he was repeatedly asked the question, you know, what is it going to take for us as a society, and here he's referring to the United States, to take expertise more seriously? And his response would be three things: war, pandemic, or depression. And it is almost alarming to realize that here we are at the middle of May, and two of those three conditions have already been met, and yet we don't seem much closer, at least in the United States, to a reestablishment of the role of expertise in public policy making. And clearly, we hope the third of those three conditions is not what is required. On a more positive note, I think we can end with the hopes that the experiences of Australia, of New Zealand, of Korea, of Taiwan, and many other nations will put forth another model, which then can become the basis for international cooperation as we slowly find our way out of the difficult situation in which we find ourselves today.